Hello, everyone. Thank you for showing up to this afternoon's webinar in our CubeSat series. Today, our speaker is Dr. Mustafa Mehta from Latmos in France, and he'll be presenting to us on InspireSat 7 or UVSQSat Plus, a CubeSat to explore the Earth. Now, if you have any questions during the course of this presentation, please feel free to type them in the chat or to raise your hand after the talk has been concluded. Okay, so without further ado, Mustafa, you may begin when ready. Thank you.
Yes, so thank you very much, Lauren. So I will start. So I will show you InspireSat 7. So we do that one with LASP, but also National Central University and Nanyang Technology University. So we work with Lauren and Amal and all team. Around InspireSat 7, so you know what is it. We have also many organisms from France, and we have also a private company. So this picture show you all people who work also with us on the InspireSat 7. So InspireSat 7 is a CubeSat. It's an application ranging from science to education. We have already one CubeSat in orbit, which is InspireSat 7. It was launched in January 2021. We developed now InspireSat 7. Launch is scheduled in 2023, and we work also on AeroSat, which is a third CubeSat. So we have three main objectives in science. So we work on Earth observation, solar physics. We do also technology demonstration. So we work on instrument miniaturization for solar physics and Earth observation. We would like to validate some technology for satellite constellation. And we do also validation of an inertial measurement units and validation of totem electronic board for ionospheric observation. And we do also a validation of the spino radioamateur payload for communication. And finally, we would like to validate also a LIFI system. I will explain you after what is it. And to conclude, we have education and outreach program, and we provide lecture and satellite development, payload development, software, and all training material. So first step is what we do in relation with Earth's radiative budget. So motivation is to follow the Earth's imbalance due to the increase of greenhouse gases. We have global temperature will increase, but regional impact is largely unknown. So we work on Earth's energy imbalance, which is related to climate change, including radiative impact of aerosol and cloud. And for this effect, we have highly variable spatially and temporally impact. And that one is associated with key uncertainty in climate science. So we would like to resolve diurnal variation, IG, every 3 hours, and for small scales. So we think we can do that one with a CubeSat constellation. So application is global climate studies, but also general circulation model for IPCC and impact studies at regional scales. So you can see on the right side of the screen view of the Earth's radiative budget. And I will show you some map about the outgoing shortwave radiation. So now I will discuss about solar irradiance. So we have motivation because we want to quantify the influence of solar ultraviolet on local climate. So we work on solar ultraviolet radiation, which penetrate deeply in the stratosphere, where there is photolysis molecular oxygen to produce ozone. So we work also on absolute solar spectrum. So I develop another Inspire mission. Next time I can show you our spectrometer, but it is a very huge CubeSat. And we work also on long-term variation of solar cycle, which are fundamental importance for solar physics modeling. And on the right side, you can see a picture of solar spectral irradiance variation. And we publish this paper to see what we observe with our space-based instrumentation. So same problematics than Earth energy imbalance. We would like to develop miniaturized instrumentation to follow that one, to follow the impact for long-term observation, and to see if there is a long-term decrease of the solar spectral irradiance. And we would like to understand all the connection, in particular what's happened at local climate and the impact of the UV on the stratosphere. About stratosphere, we see also what it is possible to do on small CubeSat. We are interested about stratospheric ozone layer, which is expected to return to pre-depletion levels in the later half of the century due to the reduction in emission of ozone depletion substance. Global climate change may slow down or even reverse this recovery in certain regions due to stratospheric cooling and circulation change. And Arctic and Antarctic regions where the ozone hole occurs are particularly sensitive to climate change. So, same problematic can demonstrate nanosatellite capability for monitoring stratospheric ozone, link observation from space and from the ground network, and study the relation between ozone variability and other geophysical phenomena with the polar region. So polar region is very good because we can use spacecraft at an altitude which is biggest than 500 kilometer altitude. And we can have a polar orbit for doing that one with a good accuracy. And another step is ionospheric studies. So ionosphere receives ultraviolet and X radiation from the sun and produces ion and electron. Electron density resulting from the ionization, which varies as a function of the local time, the season, and the solar activity. And the radio waves propagation is affected by the electron density and the emission elevation, refraction, and reflection, depending on the wavelengths. So for us, objective for these topics, it's to have a better knowledge of ionospheric behavior, to take into account the disturbance on the HF waves propagation, to have three-dimensional and dynamic ionosphere modeling for space weather, to do a vertical sounding observation, and to have elevation sounding observation and monitoring over time. And finally, we have radio amateur payload. Enthusiasts involved in non-profit educational space project decided with us to design a full libre, so free, full free, open source bidirectional telemetry board for CubeSat. The name of this payload is Pino. It's a demonstration in orbit of a new technology. Such a project needs an in-flight validation to be seriously considered as a proper solution. So we are motivation for the amateur radio community because we offer location in the CubeSat for doing that. And this project is on the good way. So we do a very good progress on this payload. And the last one is the OLEDCOM payload. So we will validate the performance and the robustness of wireless and optical technology. It is a LIFI in spatial condition. So LIFI is light fidelity. It is a wireless communication technology which use light to transmit data and position between devices. So demonstration in orbit of a new technology which benefit all these parameters. It is high speed, low latency, secured, and no electromagnetic waves. And what is good also, we would like to limit the number of wires on board the CubeSat. But main objective is to monitor outgoing long wave radiation with a CubeSat constellation. So you can see here a picture of the outgoing long wave radiation And the mean value of this parameter is close to 240 watt per square meter. And we have also to monitor the incoming shortwave top of atmosphere radiation. So here you have also a picture of this parameter and the outgoing shortwave radiation. The mean value of this parameter is close to 100 watt per square meter. Okay, so I will go to next slide. So for InspireSat 7 requirement about these topics, we need to provide absolute uncertainty of parameter, stability if we can have a constellation or a CubeSat with a long-term lifetime. We provide also stability per decade. And what outgoing long wave radiation. You have a picture of this variation done by Ceres data, but also by ERA 5 European model. For that one, we need to monitor this Earth energy balance, including radiative impact of aerosol and clouds. So we have highly variable and spatially and temporally. And key uncertainties in climate science. So we need to define parameter about our future constellation to resolve diurnal variation and small scale. For these topics, we have already one CubeSat for testing these parameters. So it is InspireSat 5, so the UVSQSAT CubeSat. And we have a satellite at LEO orbit at an altitude of 540 kilometers and a local time of ascending node, which is close to 10 a.m. Next CubeSat need to not have the same orbit. Like this, we can have a map at another local time and to see the impact of the, for example, diurnal variation, or to see what's happened at another time of observation. So this parameter is instrument identification, detailed instrument and subsystem modeling, and after, evidently, performance analysis. So for doing that, we go on a constellation. You can see here what's happened if we have a model which is a good picture that you need to draw. And if you have only one CubeSat, you can see that to have a good map, we need to have minimum of 20 days of observation. And if we have 10 CubeSat or satellite in orbit, we have a better accuracy of the picture. And the problem is to have 3 hour data. We need to have minimum of 50 CubeSat in orbit to solve and to resolve the diurnal effect. So probably it's not possible to have a constellation with each spacecraft. It's so why we think to a small constellation to do that one. So now I will go to see you the link with UVSQSAT because we have results. First step, what we do on UVSQSAT, we develop a new inertial measurement unit. With that one, we obtain the magnetic field of the Earth. And with this one, we can have the attitude of the CubeSat using also gyrometer and other parameters that we have on board this inertial measurement unit. And we can have a better knowledge of the attitude of the CubeSat because we not use an active ADCS or the pointing of the CubeSat. So we need in orbit to modify, to analyze what is the position of the CubeSat. So on the left side, you can see the evolution of the Earth's magnetic field as seen by UVSQSAT since January 2021, since the launch. So you can see here the evolution, the time evolution. So we see a very good picture of that one. something happened on the poll, but probably is artifact of the resolution or accuracy of the sensor. We do not know because we are not a specialist of the magnetic field. But we need that one to have accurate determination of the attitude of the CubeSat. For that one, we use triad method and MEKF method, multiplicative extended Kalman filter. And with that one, we obtain the outgoing long wave radiation. You can see here a map of this parameter for UVSQSAT. And since the beginning, you can see here we have the evolution of this parameter with time. So it's variation of outgoing long wave radiation since January 2021. And this one is given at one local time, one solar time, which is close to 9 a.m. hours. So why we push for InspireSat 7 to have another time, to have another data, and to see what's happened at another time, and after to see what we can have a very good picture of the OLR and for good resolution, spatial and temporal. To go to link also again with UVSQSAT, in this one you can see what we obtain for outgoing shortwave radiation. So if I come back, that one is what's happened is in the infrared wavelengths. And for this one, we have what's happened for visible. So after commissioning phase, we start observation and we go on the routine for our CubeSat. So you can see here the evolution about observation of InspireSat 5. So you can see the variation of the outgoing shortwave radiation, and you can see very good map. So we have a good result for one CubeSat. In this picture, we do a comparison between the model and UVSQSAT observation. So we can see that model did not provide information at the top of the atmosphere, but probably at the surface. There is probably a mistake, or they do probably some hypothesis. So gold, orange is the ERA 5 model, and blue is UVSQSAT observation. One sensor, now we have a full multitude of sensors, and we will increase the accuracy. And if we go to the second main objective of InspireSat 7, so I show you first one, the main objective is the Earth radiative budget. I show you the link with InspireSat 5. And now for InspireSat 7, we have a second objective, which is related to ionospheric observation. So we need to have emission with vertical sounder on ground, reception in the CubeSat, so we have a payload with antenna, plus a SDR card, which was on orbit. After, we have HF reception system and synchronized with ground emitter. So we have continuous frequency, amplitude measurements, mapping of sector obscured by environmental disturbance, and evaluation of propagation losses. We have also impact of occultation and correlation with observation by ground resources, and technical parameter for us sounding about the ground emitter, which will be in France, up to 5 minutes, and at least twice a day, twice a week, to make enough statistic, date and attitude from CubeSat platform with measurements. So why we have also this inertial measurement unit and processing of several spectrum of 2 kHz on orbit. So I provide you a list of our objective about our science and what we do. We do a link with our CubeSat, and now we'll show you the new CubeSat. So first step is the timeline. We start this project end of 2019. We have feedback, we have heritage about previous mission, we have also heritage with microsatellite in the past. We do Earth radiative budget, we do solar irradiance, we do ozone, we do ionospheric studies. We have a radio amateur payload, and we have also industrial partnership with industrial payload. We do the PDR in July. We need to provide the feedback to the reviewer because they ask us some question. And after, we hope to do very soon a critical design review, because when we do the PDR, we have already do a good progress in the technical development. This picture show you the spacecraft segment. We have also the ground segment. So we have already do that one for UVSQSAT InspireSat 7. And we discuss also with your team for all InspireSat CubeSat. So we do same strategy. We have same strategy with our partners, with Lorraine and with Amal, but also with the people from COSPAR who try to develop a small constellation of satellites. So all payload, we have a work package, a working package, and we have people which is involved in this system. This one is the implementation of all our payload. So we have the Devin payload for ultraviolet observation, the Thesis payload for solar irradiance observation. We have the ERS, Earth Radiative Sensor, for Earth Radiative Budget. We have Ozone Sensor for OSS. We have the Iono payload for the ionospheric observation. And we have a payload electronic board for radio communication with radio amateur, which the name is SPINO. And we have a system which is a payload for LIFI demonstrator. And to finish with this organigram, in this one you see all the payload and what we need to do for the test. So now I will get you a picture of the CubeSat. This one is the view of the CubeSat on the right. It's a CubeSat with a mass of 3 kilograms. It is a 2-unit. We did not have propulsion. We did not have hazardous material, and we did not want to have export restriction like ITAR. So we need to have full elements which are ITAR free. InspireSat 7 will be registered and operated by France, and we would like to have a partnership with Taiwan and all country about our consortium to see what possible to do for science, but also for operation, but also to push partnership for education, and to see if possible to have some exchange of students from France to Taiwan and Taiwan to France, because we will come back on a normal life probably, I hope, in a half year or 1 year. In this one, you see the picture of the CubeSat. So we have in external face of the CubeSat some sensors. In the black, it is the Earth radiative sensors with nanotube of carbon. And in the white, we have also this sensor, which is based on thermopile technology. And we add for that one optical solar reflector. Like this, we can map sometime the albedo or the infrared part of the Earth. So in all face of the CubeSat, we had these sensors on the top and on the bottom. So we change and we modify the size of these sensors to have a more biggest sensitivity. So it is a 10 by 10 millimeter RAA sensitivity detectors. But at the top and bottom place of the CubeSat, it is more difficult to have a biggest RAA sensitivity of the detectors. So we have a 5 by 5 millimeter sensors with a less sensitivity. If we go inside the CubeSat, we introduce also a multitude of photodiodes to observe all other parameters. And we have also inertial measurement unit that we develop in our labs, which is fully operational. And we will have also a lot of additional payload. Here you can see we would like to test miniaturized compact photodiode system with lens, and to observe the sun. If we go to InspireSat 7 world, you can see here a picture of what we have inside. So we have a magnetotorquer board. We have an electronic power supply with 4 batteries from Panasonic for the power, and additional electronic board for the communication of this electronic board. We have a transmission electronic board for UHF, VHF communication, and we have an onboard computer with a new VSQSAT daughter board for the communication with the payload. All this location is for payload photodiode detectors. And after we go to a front-end electronic to limit the length of and the distance between sensors and the electronic to limit the noise. So we use a front-end electronics. We have a main board with an inertial measurement unit. We have also an OLED COM payload for the LIFI sensors. So we will test the LIFI in orbit to see what is the impact of this technology in orbit. Here we have the radio amateur payload, which is the SPINO technology. And to finish, at the top, we have the Totem electronic board for the ionospheric observation. So we develop this also electronic board, and we do good progress. At the top, we have another payload antenna for the communication with the Totem electronic board, and to provide the information about the ionospheric observation. If you go again detail inside, so external shape, top bottom panel, we have two sensors for observing Earth's radiative budget. Here and here. This one is a print board electronic, a PCB, to connect the solar cells with the power system. And after, we use a Surtech 650 coating for gluing ERS sensors. So we have a total of 4 Earth radiative sensors of this dimension. We have a cutout on the panel for the wiring of the sensors. If we go on the lateral panel, we have more biggest size for the sensors. So we have this dimension. Locally, we have a Surtech coating, and we have a hole for the wiring of the sensors inside the CubeSat. And here we have 3 holes for the position of all photodiode for optical observation. And we have also here additional photodiode to observe all these parameters. So we use a multitude of sensors. And with that one, we already test some sensors with UVSQSAT. As you have seen, we can retrieve flux observation with good accuracy. So miniaturization is in the good way. If we go to satellite mass budget, we are close to 2.7 kilogram. We have a detailed mass budget of all elements. For power, we do the same. So we have a detailed mass budget. And what we see is the ionospheric electronic board could have a huge power consumption. So we need to use this electronic board only a few times. It's why we use that one 2 times per day or more, but not full time, because power consumption is very high. And after, we need also to follow what's happened with the power dissipation and the impact on the thermal impact of the element. So we provide here the temperature range of actual design. So we have all this temperature for storage and operational parameter, and we need to respect that one. So we go on simulation of this one. So we do mechanical analysis. So we use Nastran. We do a quasi-static analysis. We do modal analysis. We do random analysis. We do bulk analysis, and we did not have problem. So we have a positive margin. So it's not problematic. When we go to thermal analysis, we use a Zatan software, which is a European tools. We have good definition of bulk material. We have also information of thermo-optical parameters, and we can obtain our results. So we have some negative margin. So we need to find some solution because the problem is the two unit is a complex system also because power is limited. And we can see when the payload will be off, we can have negative temperature. So why inside the CubeSat, we introduce a black coating on all face to have a maximization of the homogenization of the temperature inside the CubeSat. And another problem for CubeSat, as you see, is the simulation is the high temperature variation. So we see already that one on the one unit CubeSat or the other CubeSat. So this one, we follow this problem because we can have also an impact on the lifetime of the component. So high temperature variation, high thermal cycling. When we go to ODAR, Orbital Debris Assessment Report, we do our analysis for altitude at 550 kilometers. We have inclination of our orbit, and probably we would like to go to an orbit close to 11 a.m. And the problem is, first step, we want to go to an orbit close to 12 a.m. But the problematic is the power budget and the temperature effect. So we see this orbit is problematic with the size of this CubeSat. And if we would like to have this orbit for next step, we need to add additional solar cells to have more power. So when we do the ODAR, we have no problem for to respect the loss. Loss is loi des opérations spatiales for French people. So we need to respect lifetime in orbit. We need to stay in orbit less than 25 years and to add additional element for doing the orbitation. If we did not have that one, we need to respect this rule. And we need also to respect passivation of the batteries. If there is an impact in orbit of one CubeSat with our CubeSat. When we go also to re-entry, we need to analyze what's happened with the disintegration of all elements. We need to have nothing at an altitude below 37 kilometers. And here, it's an analysis that we do with our tools to see what's happened for disintegration and fragmentation of materials. So we use parameter of the orbit, fragmentation attitude, material, and size and shape of different elements of the satellite. This parameter is compliant, as you can see. We have a fragmentation of this parameter at the end. So this one is a success. So if I go in the detail of the CubeSat, for command and data handling, we develop a daughter board, which is fully operational for UVSQSAT with a custom onboard computer. We have these parameters. We use this block diagram for the connection between onboard computer and all other electronic using also CSKB connectors. We have all distribution of the power, of the parameter, and we have heritage from UVSQSAT. CPU is based on the ARM9 system and controls all memories and interfaces. Since all libraries are based on flight heritage, we think that we have no risk identified in the data handling and interface management. One onboard computer engineering model to develop the flight software is used. We need to have a lot of bench to do a lot of tests, because we see for the first development we need to go fast, and sometimes we take some risk. We'd like to limit the risk. For flight software, we have also a strong heritage with this technology. We need to manage satellite mode to control the IMTQ, to receive and execute telecommand, prepare and send telemetry and ground visibility, update on board time, acquire housekeeping platform and payload, and to see how we can increase the time resolution acquisition. Supervisor firmware on PIC, because we will use PIC and microcontroller to control power distribution of the EOSC, to boost flight software, external watchdog and sensors to provide onboard computer temperature, voltage and current. So as explained, on OBC is based on ARM9. It is free RTOS architecture, and we use also a CNES library like PUS for telemetry, telecommand plan, but also Latmos library and a lot of libraries that we develop. We use also the HAL library and some industrial libraries that the industrial partnership provides us. For telecommand, this is from PUS, PUS library, private telecommand from PUS. For example, check memory, change time offset, downlink packet, round up data memory, housekeeping parameter. And same for telemetry. Telecommand acceptance, report, housekeeping report, dump memory, check memory, science report, technical payload. I go in another topics. We need to use our main facilities for doing the test. So we have clean room. We have huge clean room, 270 square meter. From ISO 5 to ISO 7 to ISO 8. We have a shaker for doing our vibration test, and we have also a thermal and optical vacuum chamber. All these facilities are in our labs. So it's a very good thing to have that one, because we can go more faster. Objective of the environmental test is to verify all of these things. And for InspireSat 7, we need to do vibration, shock, thermal cycling, thermal balance, electromagnetic compatibility, magnetic cleanliness, and test with the LMOT cage and calibration. For InspireSat 7, we did not do the shock test. So we need to write a letter to SpaceX to explain why. Because we have only one protoflight model, we did not want to stress, and they accept. So I think it is not an obligation to do all tests, but you need to have a mitigation of the risk. When you did not do a test, you take a risk. So we take a risk with the shock, and for the next CubeSat, probably we will not do the shock test. We study now how we can work on the compatibility and what is the win that we have with InspireSat 5 to go to InspireSat 7 to not do that one. And for vibration, we do the test at the minimum level. So it is protoflight that we develop. So acceptance level and qualification time duration of the test for random, for example. For another test, we have also all facilities in France. So we do electromagnetic and compatibility EME, EMC test in Onera and Echoic Chamber. We do the magnetic cleanliness verification in our cleanliness facility. So we have a very big LMOT cage room. And now we develop a LMOT cage, and I will show you a video about what we develop. And for doing calibration, we will go to PTB in Germany, because we need a calibration which is respectful of the SE standard. So they use a big black body for doing that one. And we already do this test for our instrumentation, solar instrumentation on board the space station on Microsat. So we already work with people from Germany. It was funny. What we need to do, because we see ADCS is a very big problem. Attitude of the CubeSat is problematic. So we need to test a lot of things, because we see that when we develop our inertial measurement unit, our calibration was not doing in depth. We finalized the characterization in orbit because sometimes we did not have all parameters on ground. So what we want to do is to develop Helmholtz gauge, to have that one in our labs, to test the impact of the microgravity and to see what's happened. So I will show you here a movie. So this one is the mechanical parameter. We take some students for doing that one with us. So we do the wiring manually. We manufacture ourselves because we have all the tools for doing that one. Here you can see the wires that we introduce on a small cube to do a test. We machine up ourselves the print board with our tools. We develop ourselves the electronic with parameters, and we machine the part. So we obtain this system, which is in development. And we have also, as you see here, a solution with the air bearing solution to have something which could be an equivalent of no gravity and to move how we can or how we want. So this one is in development and it is a very funny thing to do. About launch option, we have many options. We have Ariane solution, which is a good solution for us because we are in the European side, so we would like to use this solution. But we are also interested about SpaceX solution because it's a good thing. And during the launch of UVSQSAT, so InspireSat 2 and InspireSat 5, it was a success for the launch. We see also the Firefly Aerospace solution. But as you know, the first launch was not a success. So it is highly risky to use BravoFly solution. And there is also Soyuz solution, but we will go probably on Ariane solution or SpaceX solution, which is our two solutions. So we would like to go to Falcon 9 or probably Vega solution from Kourou, and the other one is from Vandenberg. And there is a launch, which is difficult for us because it is at the end of 2022. So we hope that there will be a sliding for this effect. We are fully operational about the MOC, Mission Operations Center, and also Scientific Operations Center. So that one, it's fully good. So no problem. We have also a website to provide data. And now I will show you, to conclude this talk, some picture about what we do now. Here, you can see a picture about the development of all electronic board. We go on a flat sat. We have all platform board. We have also starting to manufacture, to design the solar cells. You can see here our structure for the solar cells. And as you see here, we have the location for our sensors and all the holes in our solar structure. So it is on a packet. And here we can see also we test our payload. If we go to procurement of typical element, this one is the nanotube of carbon, which are on copper element. This one is optical solar reflector, which was cut with a laser, because we need to have a very good cut of this part. And excuse me. And here we have an Arduino solution to test the inertial measurement unit. And this one, as you see also, we have already manufactured two electronic board, and we test it, and we would like to improve that one because accuracy is good, but we want to do better. So we use two small components on this electronic, and we see what's possible. Oh, it's possible to increase the resolution of the inertial measurement unit. we do comparison with the MEM sense inertial measurement unit. And what is very good with what we develop, we have a low power consumption. It is close to 20 milliwatts. If you use the MEM sense inertial measurement unit, you have a power consumption which is close to 1 watt, which is not acceptable for a miniaturized solution. So now I show you scientific objective of our mission. I provide you a description about the strategy of this constellation. I provide you a picture of the development, the design of the system, and I conclude my talk with this picture to show you what we developed now for the technology and where we are in the hardware material development. And as explained, we go to the critical design review, but we have already started to manufacture and to produce the part because we think new space. And it is not possible to follow the standard process because if we follow the standard process of satellite system, we need to have 10 years to develop a system. So we take some risk. We did not like to take risk, but we limit that one. And I have finished my talk. So if you have question.
Okay, thank you very much, Mustafa. If anyone has any questions regarding the presentation, please feel free to type them in the chat or raise your hand. So Mustafa, very interesting for us to look at the number of regulations you have to comply with in France in order to launch a small satellite. Because here in Taiwan, this field is relatively less developed, so our regulatory infrastructure still hasn't fully developed. What sort of regulations do you have to comply with? Do you have to submit to the French government in order to launch your spacecraft?
Alors, yes, about regulation, we have a lot of regulation because we need to respect first. We have the space treaty, as you know, which was done in 1967. And in this one, we have all international treaty. They have another additional treaty. And for French people, when we develop a CubeSat, they act a law. So first step, we need to develop a CubeSat which need to stay in orbit for a time which is less than 25 years. After, when we have re-entry of the CubeSat, we need to have a fragmentation of all elements at an altitude below 40 kilometer altitude. And after, if there is sometime a minuscule element or material, we need to calculate the impact on the ground to see if we can have a fatal effect on the people. So that one is general rules that we need to respect. But there is additional rules because 2021, they add additional parameters. For example, when you have batteries, at the end of life of the CubeSat, we need to passivate the battery, so to kill the battery. Because the risk is, if there is an impact of a CubeSat or satellite with another satellite, we can have an explosion on space. So,
you hear me, Lorraine?
Sorry, yeah, I think you got cut off for about 20 seconds or so. So I think the last thing you were mentioning was having to passivate the batteries so to prevent explosions in space.
Yes, exactly. So we need to respect that one. And this one is problematic because probably we need to introduce a MOSFET or something to switch off the link between solar cells and the batteries. And we introduce a risk of failures. So it is very problematic. Huh? And next step, after we need also at the end to add probably some solution like a propulsion system to move the CubeSat if we need to have a maneuver on orbit. So as you know, we have information from United States about impact in orbit. And we have this information from the 18 Escadron of United States. You have same information for your CubeSat. And for example, for InspireSat 5, since the beginning, we have 5 alerts. So we can see we have something like one alert each month. So for next CubeSat, we need to respect more rules, and it could be problematic because we will add additional mass to respect these rules, and this one did not go on the way of miniaturization of the CubeSat.
Okay, I see. So a lot of regulations to comply with. In one of your earlier slides, you showed the effect of increasing the number of CubeSats in your constellation on the radiation measurements that you are making. So following EVSQ Sat Plus, do you have plans to actually build 10 or a constellation of these satellites based off of the results of EVSQ Sat Plus?
Yes, this is my objective to do that one. Today, I did not have the funding, so I will see how possible to have that one. We have also cooperation, so why we would like to add that one on a cost per discussion. So now, I did not have the budget, I did not have the funding, but we work to do that one. And we think it's a good thing to do for climate physics, for modelization, and to have a solution to observe the Earth and to provide information for people, for stakeholders, for people who can have a decision on the mitigation of greenhouse gases.
Okay. Also, I was wondering, how many people do you have on the team working to develop the spacecraft, and how many of them are professional engineers versus students?
Alors, to answer to this question, for the team, we have only professional on all the structure to manage. This is only professional. So there is scientists, but there is also engineer, and there is also additional industrial partnership in France. After we had students, as example, you see the picture I send you about the summer school we organize. So we have students, but they work only on a typical task. For example, simulation, only a typical and particular task, but we did not provide a full responsibility of a student because they need to learn. And full time, we had people who know.
Okay. Yeah, it's definitely a very valuable opportunity to learn by doing. But of course, you still need the professionals to ensure that everything can still be carried out in the time available to the standards required. Does anyone have any additional questions they would like to ask Mustafa? If you could raise your hand or type in the chat. Okay, so how long do you is your roughly how long is the required mission lifetime for UVSQ Sat Plus?
Alors, this question is also a good question because you ask me a question about the regulation law, if you remember.
Yes.
So the link between the lifetime of the CubeSat and the regulation law, when we send to our administration this documentation, we need to provide the lifetime. And for example, if I provide a lifetime of 1 year, I have the documentation which is possible for only 1 year. If lifetime is biggest, each year I need to do a new documentation. So what we need to do, and what is better, we go and we start with a lifetime minimum of 4 years. So probably the CubeSat will not be operational 4 years, but we need to have a more biggest lifetime. Okay.
Okay.
So we think it's 4 years, but for us, for example, for InspireSat 5, we have already 7 months. As you've seen, we have a lot of data. We have more than 4 million of frame. So it's now a success. For a demonstrator, 1 year is okay. Mm-hmm. So what we think to do now, and what is the best option for us, is to have another CubeSat operational with UVSQSat when they will be operation both, because two CubeSat we can test the impact of the constellation. And just one point I lose to provide you about the regulation law, we need also to take insurance of our CubeSat if there is an impact on orbit.
Okay, so what is the requirement in terms of how much you have to insure the spacecraft for, or what is the liability of that your insurance covers?
Alors, this is a big problem because there is no French company who provides that one. So we see that it's possible to take that one for English company, British. I think there is probably the same in United States. So if you want to have an idea of the cost, it is something which is close to 10 kilo euro per kilogram per year. Mm-hmm. And after that one help you if there is a problem in orbit, for example, you have a shock with another CubeSat and you need to do it's the same with a car, huh? There is a discussion, you have a protection for something which is close to 50 million of euro or 100 of million of euro. And after, if the cost is higher, this is your country who take the risk. So if, for example, we have something which is more catastrophic than 500 million of euro, the French state need to take that one at this account. And I think the big problem of these things is international law is not clear. And if there is an impact in space, I don't know what's happened. Because, oh, you can say I have a problem with you, you are the problem, or I am the problem. I think it's difficult.
Okay, that's also very interesting for us because we don't really have any similar regulations requiring insurance here in Taiwan yet, at least. I'm sure that'll probably start playing into the picture as our space law continuously is revised. Okay, are there any final questions for Mustafa? No? Okay. Well, thank you very much, Mustafa. Again, it looks like a very exciting mission, and we're very happy to see that you have a follow-on for UVS QSAT. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak with us. And yes, all the best of luck on this new mission.
Thank you very much, Lauren, and thank you very much, all people from Taiwan. I would like to thank you, Lauren, because it's very funny to work with you. Huh? You provide also full-time help. You are available. It's a real pleasure to know you and to work with you. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mustafa. Hopefully, as we go back to normal over the next year or so, we will be able to restart mutual visits.
Thank you. Thank you, Brett. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, everyone. Mm-hmm.